In this presentation, we examine the different facets of effective management and the many factors that influence it. We'll look at socialization, commitment, negotiation, persuasion, emotional intelligence, and team building, as well as other factors that lead to successful leadership.
Socialization is about the kind of control and culture that an organization wants. When done correctly, socialization has the ability to move a firm and its leadership from the merely transactional to transformational leadership. One example of effective socialization is the Ritz-Carlton. Leaders at the Ritz-Carlton started socializing their employees before they're even hired. Their hiring practices are a way to help employees feel valued, or candidates feel valued, before even becoming a part of the Ritz-Carlton. Once hired, they have a stringent onboarding process, which consists of a process of isolation, development of social ties, and focus on the key beliefs of the company. In this process, employees are basically taught the Ritz-Carlton way. They are treated as equals, and basically the motto of the Ritz-Carlton is ladies and gentlemen serving ladies and gentlemen. And one of the arguments with socialization is basically that some people don't see it as an ethical practice. However, research has shown that if you don't socialize your employees, they are going to socialize themselves.
Try the greatest move in donut spinning history. Paying attention? Behold, the upward spiraling pigtail.
Why is it called that?
I don't know!
Make the badge proud, Slater.
Yes, I think Tamara was right on in the fact of the Murphy's Law. If a manager doesn't create a socialized network, then the employees are going to do it themselves. So if the manager wants to pave the way, so to speak, it's up to the management or the leadership in the company to make sure that they set the standard, so to speak.
With leaders and managers, they can kind of go into negotiations thinking that it's a battle or a war to be won, whereas that approach is the wrong approach. It's really a way to solve problems with another party that will benefit everyone involved. And so just reframing it that way is what effective managers should be doing. And, the goal of negotiation isn't just to walk away with the deal, it's to walk away with a great deal that benefits you and the other side. And in order to do that, you have to take into consideration their position, their perspective. And it's a two-way street. They have to, they have to also take into consideration your perspective. And as long as everybody's doing that, you should walk away with a great deal. It's like focusing on the forest and not the trees. And if that can be done, if you can kind of follow that formula with some, using some soft skills interspersed, then negotiation can be a very powerful tool.
I thought the tree part was very good insight. I work one of the clients that I deal with. Sometimes I'll get a phone call from them, and it's very apparent to the other side when someone is getting into the weeds and going so granular that they're literally looking at branches instead of the whole big picture of the forest. And sometimes it can actually be very frustrating because I find that when that happens, it's hard to get on the same page because of distraction. And in the end, if you can both get to a position where you're seeing the big picture, I think it's a lot easier to come to an agreement.
All right, so my piece was on emotional intelligence. And basically what I discovered in really researching and studying emotional intelligence was all these attributes we're talking about within effective leaders is transformational leaders versus just a transactional leader, was that emotional intelligence is really necessary to instill that type of leadership. With emotional intelligence, one of the things that I talked about was having self-compassion, because I really believe that our self-compassion, if we're self-compassionate, then it reflects in how we treat others. So as part of emotional intelligence, if we are compassionate with ourselves, if how we look at ourselves, how we give ourselves the benefit of the doubt when we, you know, maybe don't do well on a paper or in life when we make mistakes, I think that really reflects how we treat other people, how we manage other people, how we lead other people, and in the relationships that we build. So having self-compassion as a leader, I think only transitions into how you are with other people. And I think if you have that, then it shows, and it only helps you become even that more of an impactful person as well as leader. So.
Leaders who succeed have both transactional and transformational characteristics. Anson Dorrance, head coach of the University of North Carolina women's soccer program, is an example of a leader who effectively uses both. Dorrance, in his 42nd year of coaching, has won over 1,000 games, has a winning percentage of over 90%, has won nearly 60% of all women's NCAA soccer championships ever played. While Dorrance may have a great soccer mind, his success is keyed by the characteristics of many great leaders: curiosity, willingness to share what he knows, and an ability and will to keep his players accountable. Dorrance uses a system called the competitive cauldron, where players are ranked from top to bottom on the way they perform in practice. This was transformational in that it created a situation where the women learned to be competitive in a safe environment, and they also learned that everything they did in practice mattered. It also identified those players who never scored very high as individuals, but were always on winning units, those players who made a team better than the sum of its parts. As a leader, Dorrance also showed incredible emotional intelligence. He adapted his competitive cauldron to player character, where each of his players ranked their teammates. However, when he saw actual names on an actual list, he became cognizant that the young woman who appeared at the bottom of it, as ranked by their peers, might suffer low self-esteem from the exercise, so he never released a list.
Twice a year, the girls get together. They evaluate each other against these core values, and then basically we're trying to finish above a 3-0. Four is, I'm an exceptional example of this core value. Three is, I live this core value most of the time. Two is, I occasionally live this core value. One is, I rarely do. And we want the girls to get feedback on this, and frankly, this stuff has transformed our culture. For years, I never shared the ranking of these core values with our girls or their grade, because I was afraid if someone had an incredibly low core value from the team, they would end up jumping off a bridge. And so finally, one year, one girl I was hoping would jump off a bridge. So I brought her into my office, and I showed her that basically no one on the team had any respect for her character. And of course, she's sitting there across the desk from me in cold silence. I'm thinking, oh gosh, you know, this is a big mistake. And I said, Jamie, are you glad I shared this with you? And in a very low voice, she said, yes. And I said, why? Because I have to change. It was the most incredible transformation I've ever seen. Of all the things we've done to implement character growth in our program, this is the absolute best. When she gave her senior speech, it's one of the greatest I've ever heard. And she talked about this transformation.
Aspect of efficient leaders is that they know how to create, build, and foster an environment that is conducive for the existence of a high-performing team. A high-performing team is defined as a team that provides delivery on objectives at the highest level of quality. They mature into an increasingly capable work unit over time, and they enable their team members to continuously develop and grow their capabilities over time as well. In short, effective teams have a great output and a greater satisfaction in their performance. Google is an excellent example of a corporation and highly effective leaders who wanted to create an environment where they could have as many high-performing teams as possible. So what they did is they began studying their high-performing teams, and they began placing different people onto certain teams, thinking that they could create a high-performing team based on who was on the team. So they started pairing people with high education and a lot of experience. And what they learned very quickly is that doesn't necessarily turn into a high-performing team. It didn't matter as much who, but it mattered a lot more about the what on the effective team. So they started to dig a lot deeper. And this study is pretty famous. It's turned into Project Aristotle. And the reason why it got that name is because the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. That a team mattered more as a whole than necessarily who was on it. So they dug deeper and they noticed that there were certain characteristics developed in each team that they found highly, highly effective. The first and most important characteristic of a highly effective team, according to Project Aristotle, is psychological safety. The psychological safety is defined as when team members feel safe to take risks and be vulnerable in front of each other. What Google found is that this is the most important aspect. Without psychological safety on a team could not be effective. And they began to measure different teams' success on creating psychological safety. And what they noticed is the more psychological safety a team had, the more effective their performance was. And lastly, what Google learned was that team members need to think that their work matters and creates change, not only for their team, but within the organization or the world as a whole. And Google lumped that into a category called impact, that team members need to believe that the work they do has a greater impact than if they weren't doing it.
I think that effective managers and leaders, one of their main goals is to strive for impact. So I think that the Google case is a great example of that, and to empower employees to feel like they do create impact. I think that's a huge transformational moment for leaders if they can instill that within their employees.
So a quality that really resonated with me that effective leaders share is the ability to foster commitment. The more committed a group is, the harder they work, the more resilient they become, and their commitment hopefully overall spreads to others as well. A leader should have the ability to draw out that commitment of others, which begins with a powerful mission statement, a vision, values of an organization at the very basis, and having the culture and beliefs of those within that organization align with those mission, vision, and values. And with those, a leader shows others where the organization is going, why they're going there, how they'll do it, how an individual can contribute, and overall the reward that awaits them as they pursue that. Steve Jobs, for me, was a really powerful example of this model. His method of business attracted a dedicated following that believe in the Apple vision. Not just Apple as a product, but the Apple vision. Jobs had that ability to captivate his audience, not just by describing all the bells and whistles of whatever the most current product was, but by how Apple as a company could improve an individual's life. He would then demonstrate how his products gave people the control. He explained the why behind the creation of his products and what a reward it was to own anything Apple.
How do you think, Dr. Abe always mentioned that Steve Jobs was a kind of a narcissist. How do you think he brought such a, or if anybody can answer this, how did he attract such a following? Was it just a belief in his product or himself? What do you all think?
I think he was an amazing inventor, right? I think what he created was, how do you deny such an amazing product, right? And that's what I'm saying, that Steve Jobs' legacy probably would have been a lot more respected, even though he is very respected. I think that he probably would have left a path for those. I think, in the books that are written about him, people would probably respect him even more had he been a little bit more empathetic and sympathetic to those that worked for him.
Interesting, Sean, that you brought up the question to Megan about what it was that made Steve Jobs effective in promoting his product. And I think a lot of that really revolves around the emotional intelligence that Megan was talking about, where Steve Jobs really had a good method that he would really appeal to people's emotions rather than their analytical thought. It was more emotional thinking, which really brought people into that emotional draw of why they wanted to commit to Apple as a company rather than just liking individual products from them. Because for me, it seems like when you have someone who really enjoys an Apple product, they have everything else Apple.
So. Yeah, and just to quickly add on to that, so kind of what Grant was saying with Steve Jobs is he knew what people wanted, which is another side of emotional intelligence, that Steve Jobs understood the vision. He understood what exactly was missing in the market, where a lot of other companies, you know, they didn't know where things were going, and Steve Jobs really figured that out and understood that and was able to drive the commitment to get there.
You know, I think the socialization is a huge piece of it. While I was working on this paper, my portion anyways, I read the article, The Powerful Way Onboarding Can Encourage Authenticity. And it was interesting to see how through socialization, if it's done correctly, people can become more authentic. And with authenticity, you can kind of see a lot about that person and kind of go at it from them, kind of figure out how to motivate them, how to encourage them in the best manner according to how they are. And I think Steve Jobs was able to successfully do that based on, you know, his exposure to the success of his product.
And Dr. A emphasized repeatedly through the course that as the effective, to be effective managers and leaders of the future for businesses and corporations, that we have a certain responsibility. And so it is wise for us to utilize this information in such a way that it has the impact, the beneficial impact on not just our own lives, but many lives. We have to be conscious of how and when our special powers of persuasion can and should be used. You know, it's interesting because in our society today, we have so many people who come to work and they have some disgruntled opinions about what's happening in the workplace. They have some anger and some bitterness. And we never know if we might be presented with employees that are harboring some hurt feelings. And one of the things that we may have to consider on a daily basis is what can we say or do that will not only help us recognize that there is a situation that can potentially go really bad for an entire company, but what can we say that might benefit this person's life? In my research, as I prepare for this paper, I talked about creating a picture. And so when you think about a picture, it has many colors and shapes and all these different things happening in the picture. And I think one of our responsibilities is not to tell employees what they are going to do, but invite them to participate in that picture and ask for their suggestions and get the buy-in that allows them to be committed and authentic. And so many other characteristics that we have described here this evening.
So that really resonated with me when you're talking about persuasion, to be mindful, because I think when it comes to being persuasive in a leadership aspect, taking that time to really understand other people, to understand where they're coming from, to explain your point of view, I think goes a lot longer of a way when you're more polite and cordial rather than being harsh and rude.
I was going to say that kind of reminded me of when we all had our residency and we first had that class with Dr. Abe. I definitely say sincerity has a huge impact on what Alan just said and what Monet said. I mean, I remember vividly the sincerity that Dr. Abe expressed to everyone during that. And I think if I remember correctly, he said, at multiple parts in the beginning and the end, love people, use things, or something to that effect.